After a long time, we have a technocrat at the helm of affairs as far as the electronics ministry goes, and that's something great. And Rajiv is also a very active citizen of Bangalore, championed several citizenship initiatives in Bangalore, which personally I have also had the privilege to have seen firsthand. And he's a three-time Rajya Sabha MP, and most recently in the latest round of cabinet expansion, Rajiv has joined the Prime Minister Narendra Modi's led cabinet. And before we, you know, request Shri Rajiv Chandrasekhar to make his opening remarks, I welcome Akash Hebbar of Avanstra, which is a Japanese-based company, to give an introduction and a welcome address, actually. Akash?
Thank you, Prasanna. That was a very good introduction. Thank you so much for transitioning it. So good evening, Honorable Union Minister of State for Electronics and Information Technology and Union Minister of State for Skill Development and Entrepreneurship, Sri Rajiv Chandrasekhar Ji. It is my privilege and honor to be here today to welcome you all to the ninth session, as Prasanna mentioned, in a 10-part webinar series on the road to Atmanirbhar Bharat. I think Prasanna has already highlighted several feathers on your cap, Rajiv Ji. So I think I will just add a few more. I would like to first of all congratulate Shri Chandrasekhar Ji for assuming the office of Minister of State in two crucial ministries. The Honorable Minister is a three-time MP from Karnataka, which happens to be my home state as well. I hail from Bangalore. He has been a national spokesman of the BJP and vice chairman of NDA in Kerala. A successful entrepreneur, Mr. Chandrasekhar is known for his passion for all things technology related and is an expert on Digital India, net neutrality, spectrum allocation, and consumer rights in cyberspace. He is also deeply committed to the welfare and modernization of our armed forces. The Honorable Prime Minister has laid out the vision for a self-reliant India, and all of us have a critical role to play in turning that vision into reality. I believe this road to Atmanirbhar Bharat will lead us to prosperity through growth, job creation, and import savings. It will also enable the Indian economy to become globally competitive. The electronics industry in general, and fabs in particular, have a huge role to play in delivering the Honorable PM's vision of Atmanirbhar Bharat. I am delighted and proud that the government has announced its intention in the form of two EOIs for India to become only the fifth country in the world to become a manufacturer of semiconductor and display fab. This will pave the way for the entire electronics ecosystem to grow in India. Over the past few years, India has shown tremendous potential and growth in the field of electronics and has emerged as the second largest mobile manufacturer in the world. The future looks bright. We are currently presented with a unique opportunity to leverage our geostrategic nature, market potential, and manufacturing resources to emerge as a new electronics hub. This will require us to capture our capacity of fabs, both in the semiconductor and the display variety. Through this, we can capture 20% of the world's display market by 2025. What the industry requires is for the government to support the industry through effective policy decisions, legal and financial support. This will help the industry create disruptive strategies and innovate. I am delighted that Swarajya has taken the initiative to organize this webinar series, which brings together experts to deliberate on the future. With these webinars, we are starting a dialogue and opening many doors that will help us actualize our Prime Minister's vision. Once again, I would like to welcome the Honorable Minister. We look forward to your address and insights on how we can all contribute to the vision of the Prime Minister and government. And I warmly welcome you all and request you all to join the exciting journey towards a strong and self-reliant India. Thank you. Over to you, Chandrasekhar Ji.
So thank you, Prasanna. Thank you, Akshay. Thank you all for inviting me this evening to speak to you. I didn't quite realize that this was going to be me speaking to all of you. I thought this was going to be more of a Q&A thing. And so in the interest of keeping it more interactive and interesting on a Friday, late Friday evening, I will try and keep my comments, initial comments, very brief, and then we can obviously have a chat amongst those of you who are interested. So, look, I think you know, the vision or the idea of Atmanirbhar Bharat is a compellingly powerful idea. It is not, as many have tried to characterize it, it is not going back to socialism. It's not autarky. It's not self-sufficiency in the socialistic way. It is about really, you know, redefining and emerging in the post-COVID world, a country with multiple capabilities and strengths, and becoming a powerhouse of many services and products for a country, for a world that is looking increasingly to a more trusted supply chain, more trusted, reliable countries and partners in delivering products and services. So I think it is an interesting sort of perfect stormish situation and an opportunity for India, having in the last 6 years, 7 years under the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, built back the financial sector, built a country which is now brimming with confidence, and being presented with an opportunity to do more than what we have been traditionally told that we are good at doing. So that is Atmanirbhar Bharat. It is really about being a globally competitive nation, being a producer and a provider of products and services across the spectrum to the world, to the Indian market, to the world, of course, and being a strategic leader in many areas of technology and in trade and economy that we rightfully can be and should be. So Atmanirbhar Bharat is a really forward-looking, is a really compelling vision of a country that is going to grow from 2 to 2.5 trillion, I'm sorry, 3 trillion to 5 trillion. But more than just the numbers, and it is about the strategic space that we will occupy in the world that we did not for so many decades and so many years. Having said that, moving closer to the areas of my current focus and passion, both in terms of technology and in terms of skill development and entrepreneurship, I think we are a country with a unique demographic advantage and dividend, which we have spoken repeatedly about for decades. But it is really under the Prime Minister's leadership that we have started focusing on taking that demographic dividend and making it seriously skilled and available to the whole world that is now looking for skills and human resources. So, you know, 5 decades ago, 6 decades ago, India, we sent a lot of people, youngsters, to the Middle East in doing a lot of things that were really basic skills. The vision now is that India will be the provider of high value, high skilled human resources to large parts of the world that are going to need this in the coming years and decades. So that, along with the fact that we have, as the Prime Minister has laid out, the ambition of India to become an electronic manufacturing powerhouse, the technology powerhouse, and the growing realization in the world post-COVID that the future of the internet and future of the technologies have to be amongst democracies and have to be about open societies rather than being controlled by, influenced by, or illegally proliferated by close authoritarian regimes like the ones that we know of. So this is the nutshell of where I'm at right now, where my views on Atmanirbhar Bharat is. I think we are at a very, very interesting inflection point as a country, as an economy, and as a digital economy. I think if we get many things right in the coming months, the upside for us as a country in terms of personal aspirations, personal prosperity, and overall economic growth, and our standing amongst the you know, the group of nations in the world is just upside and upside and upside. So I think it's just a question of working hard and getting down to it and living up to our promise and fulfilling the destiny that we've been talking about for so many years. Thank you.
Yeah. Rajiv, thank you so much. And that was, you know, you set the context for the interaction that we're going to have. So I have a lot of questions around, you know, electronic manufacturing beyond mobiles, chip manufacturing, and also, you know, the regulatory framework for the social media, big tech and all that. Before that, you know, as I just wanted to start off with a question. As all of you are aware, I think the world is still going through a very terrible pandemic. You know, a lot of countries are still, including India, has challenges in managing the fallout of the pandemic. And governments across the world have thrown everything possible at their disposal to secure both life and livelihoods as well. Rajiv, I wanted to begin by asking you from a Métis perspective in terms of, you know, the how has technology been leveraged and supported, you know, the other crucial departments in the ministry which are in the front line of, you know, fighting the pandemic, actually. So you, if you could share your insights before we move on to the other questions, actually.
No, so I think that's a big, extremely relevant question to any question, any discussion that we have in today's world about technology. You know, we've talked about the transformative power of technology. The Prime Minister, as in way back in 2014, talked about using technology to change the lives of, transform the lives of individual citizens of this country. And nowhere, and at no time has that vision and that promise of technology been so front and center in the toolkits of not just our government, but governments all around the world as we had during COVID. So, you know, technology has really been deployed during COVID in just tremendous ways. One is, of course, the most intuitive deployment of technology has been to continue to have the economy operate and continue to have the economy function. And the use of working from home, the fact that internet teledensity in this country has gone up to 800 million over the last 4 years, and that, you know, basically let the entire economy function. And to a large extent, except for that first quarter where the lockdown was very total, totally, the economy rebounded extremely fast, extremely robustly. And that is totally, in my opinion, due to the investments that we made in the Digital India ecosystem for the 4 years preceding the COVID. Second, during the COVID, I think if you see one of the biggest issues in the first wave, and indeed more so in the second wave, was this almost total collapse of district administrations. And I meant local governments. And I don't necessarily want to sound very political here, but state governments in large part, except for some few stellar exceptions, collapsed. And so citizens were really wanting to get to some place and understand. And so the apps that came out that were launched very quickly, whether it was Arogya Setu in the this thing of the first wave, and then Covin as the vaccination started, was again another significant use of technology to get citizens onboarded in terms of understanding the spread of the disease, that particular you know, place vis-a-vis the spread of the disease. And then, of course, as the vaccination hesitancy and the vaccination issues took off, the COVID gave them the way to get vaccinated. So I think technology has been extremely heavily deployed, not just between government and citizen, but even within government, in the way that government used so many different disparate groups within state government, local government, district government, and the central government, ICMR, all working together and actually connected together by platforms internally and dashboards internally. So I can assure you that technology is what has made our fight against COVID, you know, as successful as it has been. I mean, if it was not for technology, we would all have been terribly worse off. Our economy would have been in much worse shape. And so, you know, I think I was in a G20 meeting yesterday with digital ministers. And I said, look, you know, we all wax eloquently about the benefits of technology. And all we have to do is look at the last 16, 18 months and see that the power of technology is visible to everybody during such a terrible COVID pandemic.
Wonderful. Rajiv, moving on to some of the more one issue that you probably inherited as you kind of, you know, joined the Métis is the kind of the discussion around the regulatory frameworks for social media behemoth. You know, like across the world, concerns have been raised about the kind of powers that these you know, big tech social media behemoths wield, and you know, like. So essentially, we see two models that have emerged, Rajiv, just to summarize very quickly. One is like the Chinese model, as you just kind of briefly alluded, you know, this relentless crackdown with no consideration, no process, no judicial setup. It's just government decides and cracks down. And then you have the US model, which is bit I would call like all bark, no bite, because they kind of threaten to invoke antitrust. And, you know, there's a very deliberative process. Nothing much happens. So where do you see India's regulatory architecture emerging, especially, you know, you saw despite you know, the rules that we put in place, Twitter seemed like a bit obstinate. And, you know, like, so even despite having very well regulated rules and conditions, so how do you think this regulatory architecture is going to evolve and kind of, you know, we are a democratic, diverse country. We need a good dialogue and discussion going on. And of course, social media provides that opportunity. How do we balance these differing objectives where sovereignty, you know, free speech, debate, everything, and we have a regulatory architecture built around all these issues, Rajiv?
So, no, I think it's a good question. So the firstly, I think straight off the bat, let's all be very clear that we are not China. We don't want to be China, and you know, and China will do what China has to do. But we are not China. We are a democracy, a vibrant democracy. We are a we have constitutionally guaranteed rights, fundamental rights to all our citizens of free speech. We have a constitutionally guaranteed right to privacy. These are constitutionally guaranteed. These are not. These live beyond governments. These have nothing to do with government. These are written into our constitution. And this is a right that every Indian citizen gets when he's an Indian citizen. Our approach to regulation has always been, and if you look at Prime Minister Modi's approach from day one, has been to enshrine into law specific rights for consumers. So if you look at, for example, the Real Estate Regulation Act, there was a lopsided relationship between the builders and home buyers in this country for several years, several decades. And so we wrote into law, and I was part of the select committee of that law, where consumers have rights and builders have obligations to the consumers that they serve. That say similar model is the model that we are following even in technology with the intermediary guidelines. The intermediary guidelines are not designed to make the government do anything particularly good or bad against intermediaries. It is designed specifically to enshrine into law the fact that consumers that are served by these big tech platforms or any platform for that matter have rights. And that these intermediaries cannot ignore those rights. So if you, Prasanna, are a user of a platform X and you have a problem with that platform, you have the legal right now to question that platform or write to the platform to its chief grievance officer. And it is an obligation cast on the chief grievance officer to respond to you.
Absolutely.
So that our model, and I think India is going to pioneer this. India is the first amongst all of our democracies in the world to evolve a framework of regulation or rules or do's and don'ts for these platforms that have long, in a sense, escaped any form of accountability to the users because of the safe harbor under Section 79. We are now initiating a model that is basically about creating accountability to those who they serve. And the government has very little to do with it. So it is, if you have a problem, you as a consumer have a right to to ask Twitter or Facebook or any intermediary, for that matter, to hold themselves accountable to you. Now, this is evolving jurisprudence. This is evolving regulatory framework, Prasanna. So there is never going to be a day where you look at these regulations and say, oh, wow, we've got it perfect. Because all of us are working through what nobody has ever walked through. I mean, these are all new challenges today that we are facing. Nobody ever expected in 2008 when we were all celebrating the benefits of in the internet, and we're all celebrating the benefits of social media and how the internet and social media connected people and allowed exchange of ideas and all the good things that the internet represents. But nobody thought there were all of these things where consumers and hundreds of thousands of consumers would feel discriminated, or they would feel abused or attacked or be subject to things on this platform and go desperately looking for justice and recourse. So I think that is the model that we have embarked on as a country.
Wonderful.
I personally think as an individual, before I became a minister, I liked this. I was very much in support of this model because I think it is not the place of government or indeed any regulator to start, saying that I'll ban this platform or I'll ban that platform. That has to come out of law. That has to come out of a natural evolution of the jurisprudence around this whole internet.
Correct. I also see that the government is strictly going by playbook and the rule book while even dealing with all these social media behemoths. Yeah. Wonderful to hear that, Rajiv, that this is the kind of evolving jurisprudence, and of course you have a basic model already in place. Moving on to the next question, Rajiv, there are like two parts to it. One, first of all, need to acknowledge that NDA has done a phenomenal role in spearheading the mobile manufacturing initiative in the country. As you may be aware, India's the government has kind of catapulted the mobile manufacturing to the second largest in the world. So we do a lot of assembling and manufacturing, but the significant part of the value chain still remains outside India. Like for instance, the display unit is something that typically constitutes around 25% of the value chain, and a lot of other critical components. I'm not even talking about the design part of it, but even within the hardware, quote unquote, the hardware part of it, there's a lot of things to do. So we have various schemes. I know there is a spec, there is, of course, PLI, and then there is EMI. So what do you think should be the way forward for us to move up the value chain in the mobile manufacturing, as well as the beyond the basic assembling and manufacturing? How do you see yourself actually, in terms of policy initiatives?
Look, Prasanna, I think the Prime Minister's vision on this and ambition for electronics manufacturing is very deep and significant. It is not, it doesn't stop at the mobile phone manufacturer. It extends to obviously multiple categories of OEM and platforms. And that is in terms of the breadth of it. And then deeper going down in terms of getting the supply chains of components, sub-assemblies, systems, and the design of them also becoming part of the electronics manufacturing ecosystem. So the ambition doesn't stop with the mobile phones, Prasanna. And this is something that I want to make very clear. The Prime Minister's brief to us at our ministry is that we have to build and create a robust electronics manufacturing ecosystem that goes all the way from the actual device or the platform or the product to the multiple layers of value that are below it. We have gone from a country that had very limited electronic manufacturing in the late 2018s, late 2012, 13, 14. And then we have spiked up from 1.9 lakh crores to 5.3 lakh crores in just 4 years. So we are at early stages, and there was tremendous damage done to our domestic manufacturing supply chains and domestic manufacturing itself in the years where the free trade agreement with certain countries were just allowed to run riot in this country. So, you know, from in the early days of 2005, when the trade surplus or the trade deficit with China was $1 billion to becoming $55 billion in just over a decade, that clearly was at the cost of much of the existing supply chain and manufacturing ecosystem in the country. Now, we are building it back. And the PLI and the MCEPs and all of these are part of an, the Prime Minister's strategy to not just bring the OEMs and the platforms, but to also bring the supply chains into India and or develop their supply chains in India. So to answer your question, I think that is our ambition, that we definitely want to go down deep. We want to create, encourage investments to come here and manufacture not just the end product, but also the PCBs, the assembled PCBs, the design of them, the components that go into it. And as we go down deeper and deeper, and hopefully to that, you know, the missing link in the entire electronics supply chain that we've had for many, many years, which is the fab.
Correct.
The semiconductors. So right. That is the ambition, Prasanna. Make no mistake about it. We have huge ambitions there, and we are working hard to realize Prime Minister Narendra Modi's ambition.
Yeah, I mean, just like kind of tangentially got into the next question that I wanted to ask Rajiv, and this is something where you have very deep domain experience. Plus, you know, you have also energetically championed this cause in the parliament as well earlier. Okay, this is basically fab in India. As you might be aware, you know, this almost this even this countries that traditionally were not very serious about onshoring chip manufacturing, I think like after this global semiconductor shortage, you know, almost every country, EU, Japan, even the US, you know, they are kind of wanting to onshore back semiconductor manufacturing within the borders and giving huge incentives as well, actually. And India also, you know, basically, we need to, if we have to create a national champion in chip manufacturing, obviously there is a lot of government support that would be required given the sheer scale of it, actually. And good to see that government of India has launched a EOI and wanting to do something on it, Rajiv. From your understanding and also, you know, from the recent insights that you have picked up, how do you see this going? And, you know, what is the kind of, you know, roadmap that we can hope on this particular area, Rajiv? I would like to hear from you.
No. So, like I said, Prasanna, I think it is clearly on the radar of this government. And it is clearly something that the Prime Minister has laid out as being part of an overall electronics manufacturing strategy. But there are, you know, many ways of belling that cat. We have an EOI out, as you correctly noted. But, you know, we will cross the road. I mean, you know, getting into the fab business is neither easy nor trivial, nor something for the faint-hearted. I mean, we're getting into serious, you know, investment, seriously cutting edge technology cycles. And so it is really at the highest end of both design and manufacture.
Correct.
And it's not something that you should just jump in without being very clear about, without having strategic clarity of where that fits in with your overall strategy. Do you have other strategy pieces in lined up and ready to use this investment, et cetera, et cetera. So I would just say at this stage, I think we realize the importance of the semiconductor piece in the overall EDSM, you know, the electronics ecosystem. We have also parallelly looked at fab, you know, encouraging fabless semiconductor businesses and industries and ecosystems. So while on one hand, we are pushing the design side of the technology business and expanding that from the current 200 billion. We have ambitions to make that at least 500 billion in the next 3 years by including ER&D, semiconductor design, SaaS, all of these other pieces, apart from just the old software solutions piece. On the hardware piece, the fab is clearly at the highest end of that kind of manufacturing. So
I will just say at this stage that we are exploring it. And I think as a country, we should have access to the technology. We should have that if we are to be an electronics power. But if today I say, yes, we are going to do it, or, you know, it's going to be done on so-and-so date and stay tuned, I would be misleading you. So I can only say, you know, just stay engaged and see how this roadmap to becoming an electronics power plays out over the next 3 to 4 years.
Wonderful, Rajiv. Thank you so much. The next question, Rajiv, is slightly in the convergence of your two ministries that you, you know, kind of oversee. See, you might have kind of heard about headlines in several, I mean, seen the headlines in various newspapers about the serious skill shortage in India's high-tech capital, Bangalore. You know, you have serious shortage of engineers to the extent that the companies are, you know, moving heaven and offering, you know, whole sort of slew of incentives to get employees joined. On the other hand, there is also this unemployment, you know, anecdotal accounts of unemployment as well going on. So how do we kind of, you know, look at a comprehensive skill strategy where, you know, the and what is the kind of you know, program that the skill ministry is working on, where, you know, we kind of address various skill requirements across the economy?
So specifically to the technology sector, Prasanna, MeITY, that is the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, runs its own skilling and you know, talent expansion programs, and they have an organization called NILIT that is that has multiple centers all over the country and trains over 10 lakh students every year. And then, of course, there is the Skill Development Ministry, and that does a lot of other, that does training, and even there is a skill, you know, in the lakhs of in the lakh in terms of numbers. I think there is. If you're absolutely right, currently India post COVID, the technology sector is suffering from the problems of plenty. And I know companies that are being given contracts that are, you know, beyond their capacity to execute, and they are just not able to ramp up fast enough to execute their opportunities. And there's a lot of overflow into other companies and so on and so forth. Now, this is a fact, and I think it's ironical that you asked this question, because yesterday I took a review of all the our talent management and the talent expansion strategy, and the ministry, the team at MeITY took a decision to almost double or if not triple the capacity to train in the next year. So we are seized of the problem, and it is a real problem that we have to get more and more people for this growth industry and to fuel the growth of this opportunity. And we are doing this. You know, beyond that, I can't say anything else, because this is we are going through. Like I said, you know, most countries go through a problem of shortages. Right. Shortages of business, shortages of growth opportunities. We have an interesting situation where we have tremendous opportunity to grow in the next 2 to 3 years, really a step function type of a growth model for the technology sector. And we are, in a sense, currently limited by the number of people who can fuel that growth. But we are engaged, we understand the problem, we are engaged with the problem, and our ministry, along with the Skill Development Ministry and the Education Ministry, which is Higher Education Ministry, are working on that to address it in as short a time as
possible. Wonderful. Rajiv, that brings me to the last question, which kind of, you know, ties into some part of your opening remark, actually, on the Atmanirbhar in, like, say, electronic manufacturing and semiconductor. I was very happy to hear that you kind of see Atmanirbhar initiative not as a throwback to the old days of, you know, statism and socialism and, you know, that kind of a model, But certainly, you know, if you're talking about Atmanirbhar in this space, it would require a certain amount of intelligent crafting of policies. Let's say, you know, some way of privileging and differentiating homegrown entrepreneurship, homegrown products, you know, data laws and various other differentiated initiatives without, you know, explicitly discouraging foreign capital and expertise and all that stuff. So what do you think would be a good way to look at this, and how can we craft an approach where, you know, like even some people talk about extreme scenarios like, you know, tech and data colonization, India might face that kind of a, you know, of course, that's a probably a very far-fetched scenario, but there are apprehensions around that as well.
I think what the Prime Minister has repeatedly said when he talks about Atmanirbhar Bharat is that it should be made in India, designed in India. So if the person making it in India is American or French or Italian or, it doesn't matter. We welcome all investors, subject to them not being from, let's say, any terrorist supporting country or, you know, some crazy countries like that. So the vision of Atmanirbhar Bharat is that Indians have to be occupied in creating value in India for whoever is the investor. And the investor is equally welcome from Singapore, from Japan, from Western Europe, from the US to any geography, including Indians, Indian entrepreneurs. So that is the prime focus of Atmanirbhar Bharat. To add it to that, of course, and especially a government headed by Prime Minister Narendra Modi would love for more and more Indian brands, more and more Indian products to proliferate, to be competitive, to be globally competitive. But I don't think anywhere in our radar is protectionism. That means there is no protectionism for an Indian-owned company versus a foreign-owned company manufacturing in India. I don't know if I'm making my point clear. So for us, as a government, there are no two classes of investors. There are no two classes of people creating jobs. There are no two classes of people creating economic growth and opportunity in this country. However, like any responsible government, any empathetic government, we have schemes that are aimed at creating Indian entrepreneurs, to create Indian intellectual property, create Indian technology, create Indian products, create Indian platforms. And that is almost certainly going to continue stronger, more better funded going forward. But government as a customer, government as as somebody who is going to procure or even enable investors, there'll be absolutely no discrimination between any investor in India, Indian or foreign.
Wonderful. On that extremely philosophical note, Rajiv, we'll end this webinar. And I really appreciate you for, taking a wide range of questions. Wishing you all the best as you take forward the initiatives in the Meiti and as well as in the skill department, Rajiv. All the best. And thank you so much, listeners, for joining in on a Friday evening. Thank you so much.